love that. I am Rakia Finley. I am the founder of Surge Assembly, which is a database development firm for nonprofits. We build complex data solutions, including Salesforce solutions, as well as take that data to allow our organizations to make smarter decisions. I'm also the co-founder of Fin Digital. We are a mobile application, digital development, IoT development firm. So we build a lot of really complex digital solutions on top of Salesforce instances, as well as a number of data, other database housings. So we are going to talk about a fun topic, which is addressing user experience design, addressing unconscious bias in user experience design. So it's going to be really slightly uncomfortable, but very productive conversation. That's how I like to address it. So first, we want to honor said sponsors, give homage to them, and thank them for their support and love. So everyone bow their heads and an appreciation, right? All right, cool. So I am Rakia. As I said, we believe that technology should work in all facets, and that means we believe in the power of a powerful emoji. There's nothing more that presumes having more unconscious bias in an emoji. I don't know what does. So just a couple fun things about me. I went to school for sociology. Really?
Yeah.
Yes! And then with that, fell in love with data, and that's how I became a database developer. After that, I went to school and got a business degree, and that love of computer and business and data became true. And with that, I've started a number of companies, and from their baby stage, this is from their baby stage to their big stage. Get it? Okay. I love the power of people and technology. It's opened a lot of doors for me, and I appreciate every single door, and it's allowed me to own a number of firms. I am an avid bike rider. I'm a mother and a wife, and I travel the world talking tech with my said co-founder. I encourage everyone to do an emoji bio. It's really fun. So what are we going to do here? We're going to be talking about two very specific things, and that is how user experience unconscious bias affects the way users interact with technology and what we're really telling these users to do when we develop, and then what's our role and responsibility as we're building these technology solutions, and how are we affecting bias when we're building. So just to get a show of who's in the room, where are my admins? Nope. Okay. All right. Developers? Okay, nice. Neither? Just, okay. And then designers? No designers in the room. Yes! I love that. We are all designers. That's fantastic. Okay, cool. So the big part is, what is unconscious bias? I always say unconscious bias, everyone has it, right? It's our knee-jerk reaction. It's actually our safe space. It allows us to make very smart decisions very quickly, be very decisive human beings. It's not a bad thing to have. However, what happens in unconscious bias is as we build, right, as we have these building blocks of protection and knowing things and being able to say 1 + 1 = 2 very quickly, we also generate biases and that necessarily aren't the healthiest and actually aren't really rational. So though we may say, my unconscious bias tells me not to go down a sketchy alley at 2 o'clock in the morning, right? I also have unconscious bias that might tell me not to talk to a particular person because they don't make me feel safe, right? Both of those come from an element of fear and wanting to protect ourselves, but they're not always the best decision making. So what I want us to do today is really to activate what our unconscious biases are, truly understand the power of those things, and be honest with ourselves about which ones aren't right and which ones are, and kind of do some remapping. So to do that, we're gonna have to go through a couple of things. And once we do that, we're gonna really talk about how, when we activate our unconscious bias, what then can happen as developers, designers, and admins. So just some things about unconscious bias that are really interesting is that we're very unaware of the type of biases that stem upon prejudices, right? Where it's easy for us to kind of see the obvious of prejudice, but we truly don't really know when it falls very deeply and subconsciously into ourselves. And it allows a response to others based on a number of indicators, either positive or negative, and those assumptions generate action. So we're gonna talk a lot today about how those assumptions generate action. That's gonna be a big part of our conversation. So here's some pretty interesting things about the bias blind spot. That is, it's pretty obvious of most people have no idea about the biases they have. We most definitely know about the biases other people have, and we feel more comfortable talking about those people's biases than we do about talking about our own. And it's not fun to talk about personal biases. So everyone has this. We all hone this like a little AA meeting, like, hi, my name is Rakia, and I have unconscious bias, right? So we just want to live in that. So before we kind of get started, I need us to kind of activate our unconscious bias. Because the part of being a really great designer and developer is knowing when your unconscious bias is taking effect, knowing how to address it, and then keeping yourself to move forward. So, simple activity. Who does this phone belong to? So what I want everybody to do is I want you to study said phone, everything about the phone. I want you to look at the apps and the phone and everything. I want you to then close your eyes. I want you to envision the person holding this phone. And with this, I want you to be very honest with yourself. I want you to picture their outfit, everything about them, right? So everyone kind of tell me when you got your person. They're sitting right next to you, like you got your person with this phone. Does everyone have their person? All right. So I want to ask you to answer a couple questions about your person. So what is their gender? How old are they? Are they important at their job? What race are they? How knowledgeable are they about technology? Are they an admin or a dev? Most importantly, would you hang out with them? Everyone have their answers? All right. Who wants to tell me about their person? Okay. I'll go with you and then we'll go with you. Okay. How old are they?
Young.
Okay, young. Are they important?
Not really.
Okay. What race are they?
I'd say white.
Okay. Knowledgeable about technology?
Reasonable, knowledgeable.
Reasonably
not.
Okay. Cool. Why do you say that?
Because it's Japan.
Okay.
Social media consumption.
Mm-hmm.
Are
they admin or dev?
None.
Neither. Okay, what are they?
Like a young girl, teenager, stuff.
Okay. Would you hang out with them?
Yeah, why not?
Okay. All right. That seemed fun. Okay. All right. You're a person. Which thing?
The sports thingy.
Sports center.
Okay, the sports center.
Health or the health.
That's the health app.
Okay, gotcha.
All right.
Okay, so now I'm thinking it's a guy, it's a little girl.
Okay.
I think they're young. I don't know whether or not they're important at their job.
Okay.
I would put them at medium importance, but I think all people are important. I'll go with white, but I'm not sure. They're just as knowledgeable, probably a little bit more knowledgeable than the average person about technology, but they could be very, very knowledgeable, I still think, though.
Okay.
I would say they're an admin because I don't see anything super geeky. And would I hang out with them? If they lived in my neighborhood, I hang out with anybody who lives in my neighborhood.
Okay. Now, let me ask you a question. How did you feel about the fact that you didn't know what those apps were?
I didn't care.
Okay.
It's like, I don't know what's in your closet, and I don't care.
Okay. Okay. And then when you found out what those apps were, it brought this person.
I knew him, and he knew that it was for.
Oh.
And I actually targeted him as a demographic group for entertainment.
Okay.
For a free volunteer. Because I stereotype 25-year-old white men having plenty of time on their hands.
Okay. In that case, I want to be a 25-year-old white man. That's fantastic. Okay, so who kind of disagrees with the two opinions of who this person is? Who kind of just like, okay.
I wouldn't want to hang out with them because their photo app is not next to the camera app.
Okay, say it again. Their photo app is...
Yeah, if you take a picture, you're going to have a photo app right next to it.
Oh. Oh, okay.
This person's
a madman.
My wife has thousands of emails, leadership emails.
Before we dig ourselves any deeper.
So we all do realize that we've activated our unconscious bias, right? We all do realize that we can't actually identify who a person is and judge who a person is based off the technology that we have. But then we also realize that we do. Now, what I usually hear in these situations, most definitely when there's developers, is they simply can't get past the fact that it's an iPhone. And they're just like, right, they're just like, this person is not serious. Okay. Oh, well, there you go. Right? So. Are we ready to find out who this person is?
Yes.
All
right.
It's me. Yeah. So, and this is, we're like, let's talk about this. Like, we need to really figure this out, right? And so, I actually don't like sports, but I do love the API of the ESPN's Zone app. So I love to see how it functions. It has way too many notifications. It's really annoying. But they push the limits on the notification pushes that any app has ever had. So I find it really, I study it a little bit. It's really frustrating. So, yeah. And my unconscious bias is it has so many notifications because it's targeted towards men, and men don't pay attention to their phones as much as women. So I wonder if that's the reason. But no, this is me. I am an admin. I'm also a dev. I think I'm pretty cool to hang out with. I'm a woman of color. I am in my 30s, so all of you are wrong, right? But some of these apps I have on my phone because I think the tech of the app is really interesting, and I love studying tech. I love simplistic apps that have complex backends. Majority of these apps have that, so I think it's very cool. I never realized that my camera was not next to my photos thing, and that's a nice little... I don't like folders. I forget what's in the folder. Yeah, I hate folders.
But never
know,
that's good.
Yeah, sometimes I use it, yeah. I put it there so I can remember to use it, and I don't. Yeah.
Like so everybody else.
Yeah, yeah, so it's a reminder to myself. And I'm a big music person. So, we have activated our unconscious bias. Right? We now kind of, you guys feel that muscle kind of working? We now know what that is, where we're guessing and we're assuming and we're feeling, right, all at the same time. That's what unconscious bias is. The thing that happens to really smart people like us is we allow that same muscle to build technology. So this is, if anyone, someone says, is there more activities like this? There are. Harvard actually did an amazing thing where you actually can go and find out you can take all these really cool implicit bias tests and figure out where your unconscious biases lie. And then it'll give you some really cool activities around how to target and how to counteract and remap those unconscious biases to allow you to be a little bit more implicit. I'll be tweeting throughout the day some other really cool, MTV actually really has a really cool unconscious bias website, weirdly enough. So there's a lot of really cool activities out there on the web that I'll be tweeting throughout the day. You can follow me on Rekia MC. So, the reality of tech, the reality of where we work and the industry that we work in is we have a preconceived notion of what technology looks like. We also have a preconceived notion of what developers and people in tech look like. And sometimes we feed into that reality, and what we then have, if we feed into it, is a team that really doesn't reflect diversity and doesn't allow enough opinion to counteract unconscious bias. So what I want to encourage you to do is get to the point where we understand that tech can look like anybody and anything, right? There's no dress code to tech. There's no particular demographic of who belongs in the tech industry. So we kind of want to reroute our unconscious bias around that. So now we're going to talk about the power of user experience design. There's a responsibility that we have as digital developers where we're telling society how technology should function. And with that, we're telling society of what they should think about people who interact with certain types of technology forms. And what we've realized is, with those assumptions, we then gauge experiences. With those experiences, we are actually forming additional unconscious biases to the end user. So how do we not do that anymore? Actually, before we go there, I want to give a couple of simple examples about how unconscious bias shows up in user experience design. Now, we all here believe in the power of data, correct? And we believe in building beautiful data houses. To generate a beautiful data house where beautiful and powerful data that you don't have to dedupe and clean comes into your system, we create triggers and validators to make sure that doesn't happen. We don't realize that when we do that, we actually are generating an unconscious bias of what we perceive as the end user. So one example that happens a lot in educational institutions is the name validator. This is actually a problem that we were asked to fix because an application did not allow a number of professors in the school to allow themselves that weren't Americans to put their names into the system without it saying, you don't belong here. So, but everybody knows the first rule to having a solid first name in your database is, what do? How do you validate? What's like the knee-jerk reaction to making sure you have a really good first name system in your database?
Longer than
zero characters, right? Has to have a capital in the beginning.
Yeah.
No spaces, right? No dashes. So we do it, but that's actually unconscious bias if we have a perceived notion of what a first name should be. It's not over 20 characters, right? So here is another example. I was very surprised when I realized this was actually real.
What? I don't know. Somebody put that in there.
The capitalizations are weird in that message. I don't know.
Right?
That's a little strange.
You have.
You have.
Doctor.
I'm biasing us.
It depends on what depends on what country.
Right. This was an American web app,
mm-hmm.
But
really?
that's a great fighter. But no, unfortunately not. Is it gonna come up by itself? All right, this is my last one. Yeah. So, sadly enough, these are actually real things that are in the internet right now. We have to understand that it comes from that same knee-jerk reaction muscle that we were just talking about. Of preconceived notions. Oh, I forgot I had this one. This is a very good example. So I don't know does anybody remember when this bot was deployed on Twitter? It was a computer learning bot that was deployed on Twitter that was learning the tweets that were happening, and then it was trying to be a natural language after that. So Twitter was telling it how to think, and then it gained an opinion. All right, so. It's another example. So when we do this, how do these things happen? How does this actually generate all these unconscious bias moments in technology affect? I believe that unconscious bias begins to happen in the discovery phase of a digital solution. So it's easy for us to say, well, it happens in the actual deployment and the implementation, but it actually happens in the conversation of the solution that you're building. And with that, you have to always talk about who you're building it for and then stretch yourself to go beyond. So I want to do a quick activity. It looks like I should have time to do said activity. Very quickly, I just want you guys to form a group of three. Let's form a group of three. Okay, two or three, two to three, two to three. Yes, two to three, that's fine. Okay. Great. So everybody has their group? Well, I didn't, we're talking, we're ideating already. Okay. So is this is the group of three? This is the group of three, this is the group of two. I'm assuming this is the group, this is the group. This is the group of three, okay, and this is the group of three. Okay, right, so we did the activity, you all failed.
Yep.
Right, we all failed. Right, well, not just that, yes, that is correct. Three white guys, but only two people got up, I believe. You got up, and you got up to move over so he'd get up, right? So in the moment of ideation and discovery, this is what happens in technology, where one person says, hey, I have this digital solution I want to build. I need a group, I need a team, because my boss said so, right? So you and you, let's talk. And we don't stretch ourselves past, I need perspective and diversity, and I actually need to walk and say, okay, I don't know what activity she's going to ask us to use, but I know I'm good at this, and I know I don't have an opinion of that, that, and that. Who's in the room? Let's figure it out, and let's have a real strong discussion about the digital solution, and push me past the user that I'm talking about. Because more than likely in technology, if you guys are building a solution, you're going to talk about this fantastic user that you're building the solution for. What race are they? Okay. Right? But your knee jerk, you're going to start talking about this user, and you're going to have a preconceived notion of what the user, you're going to see that person sitting, just like we did with the whose phone is this, right? And because no one's challenging, because we have a perceived same demographic, your user probably in all your minds are going to look like your team. So now we're not building for a woman, because you don't have a perspective of one. Right? How many, what phones do you guys have? All iPhones?
Yes.
So now we're not building for the person that has an Android or a BlackBerry. You never do anyway. Shame. Right? So age range?
42,
35, 40. Okay. So where's the 20-year-old? Where's the 50-year-old? Right? So it's very easy. Now that's a very easy demographic when I come back here. So now we're talking about our digital solution. What gender are they? Okay. Now you're gonna fight back, right? It's gonna be very easy. Now what usually happens in a group of women that's building a digital solution, they start talking about their frustrations and their issues with technology and their needs for the solution to affect them. So then what do they forget? We forget all the awesome white guys. Right? Who, I hope not everybody has an iPhone in here, but who here has a team that you guys have different devices? Anybody? Okay. Oh, you have both. Okay, you guys have different devices. Okay, so at least we're solving that problem, right? All right. So now do we see how that feels? See how quick that can happen in ideation and how that quickly can affect our technology solution? You can stay in your group or you can leave your group. I think you're the only one that got up, so it's a personal choice. But you want to stay within your group, right? So, okay. Oh, no. So what happens, because in this exercise we're acknowledging, let's say we stay within our group, right? You're saying, Rakia, I only work in a small group, like I can't in my everyday life change and create this diversity discovery phase you're talking about. Well, what do we do? So then when we talk about our user, we want to be very honest with the elephant in the room about the unconscious bias that we have. So then we start talking about our user, somebody actually says, who is our user? And if we look at that demographic and we realize we're not stretching beyond ourselves, then we have to say, okay, we need five users, right? We need the typical, we need the non-typical, we need that they're never gonna touch this app again. And in the world of building MVPs and making sure we get users and making sure we make money on deployment, it's very hard for us to do that, right? Because we've been taught for a very long time, you build for that exact user that you know is gonna buy your solution and never the two shall meet of the person that's never gonna give you any money. But what you've done is, one, you've told the user who they are. You've told an end user how they're supposed to interact with technology. And now this person that maybe doesn't fit into your demographic that would have used your solution is constantly being told that they don't belong there. So you've actually blocked yourself out of new opportunities of technology. So we want to make sure that we always do this in our discovery phase. Then when you get past that discovery and you actually start building the digital solution, we want to talk about how you built that data structure and how we built those validation rules that we believe make us look like really great developers, but actually we are isolating and ostracizing a user group that we really don't know much about. So how do you do that? You really audit your validation rules and ask yourself, are the validation rules allowing you to be a lazy developer, which we all do, right? That's when we say the no spaces and the no dashes and the capitalizations, right? That means I don't have to spend 2 hours a day cleaning data. So you really want to really challenge yourself in your validation rules. You want to truly validate your assumptions of the user. When you say like, oh, we're building this app for someone in the span of 25 to 35, you really want to ask yourself, why is that reality for you? And then user testing is really important when you actually deploy. So the same thing that's happening within our groups happens when we do our beta. So then when we launch an app or we launch an enterprise, we go to like the 5 people, it's like test this really quickly and tell me this is right or wrong. And usually those are the people that are in the quickest reach of us. And we don't really stretch beyond, and then they come back and say, this is great, right? You guys did it. But then we never really tested it on all aspects of demographics. So you really want to stretch yourself to find a user base that isn't just emails, but is actually challenging your user profile. And then you always want to reference user personas when you're doing your user experience design. So what does that mean? So if I'm saying that my user persona is a woman in the age of 25 to 40, she uses an iPhone, and she looks at her phone 5 times a day. And then I build a mobile application that does push notifications every 2 hours. So I'm really not paying attention to my user persona. I already just told myself that she looks at her phone 5 times a day. Why am I pushing her to look at her phone more? So you really want to challenge your user persona to the functionality components that you're doing within your mobile application. Yeah, my phone keeps. All right, so now let's build. When the Apple Watch fails you. So, of course. All right, so let's talk about the unconscious bias in the user experience design process. One thing that you'll notice in all of this is majority of this is happening during ideation and under discovery. So at our firm, we actually do this entire process before we even build a solution. That's a lot more discovery work, so I'm not telling you to do that, but if you can find a way to do that, you definitely should. Now, the first one is empathize. This word gets used a lot when unconscious bias gets talked about in technology, and it gets challenged a lot. What is empathy in user experience design? All it is finding the common denominator between you and the user you know nothing about. So getting down to the simplest component of what is needed. So it's very easy just to say, well, we have a user, we're building an Android app, nobody has an Android app, we don't really know why we're building it, but whatever, right? And then we have who we are, and we need to find a common place of empathy between that Android app. Or we say, all right, we're gonna build a web component for the people out there in the world that have Windows devices, and we hate them, and we think they're stupid, right? So now we have to come to a certain point of empathy. If there's information they need and there's functionality that they need, let's come to the very most simplistic need of functionality that no matter what device you have, we're gonna build for it, right? So even though if it's not as pretty or shiny as the iPhone app or the Android app, it still has that functionality that shows empathy that everyone belongs here. Then you wanna define. So this is, for me, the fun part is after you have this empathy and you have this list of functionality, you have these lists of features, now we're gonna talk about the languages, now we're gonna talk about the devices that we're utilizing, now we're gonna talk about the information that we're pushing in and pushing out. And then, of course, we're gonna challenge that with our persona. So now we have the empathy, which is our basic set of features. Now we have the technology that we're gonna use. So now we're gonna ideate. Now we're gonna talk about how we're gonna make this thing shiny and new and awesome. Right, usually what happens is ideation comes first. I want to build this really cool app that does this really cool thing, and it's going to be awesome. All right, let's go. Right, we do ideation first, but actually we're going to talk about the empathy of the user, generate our features, define the languages and procedures we're gonna utilize, and now we're gonna ideate about the new and shiny. So now that we have this foundation of awesomeness, now we can begin to prototype. Prototyping is validating. It's really easy to just prototype just to get something out, to look at it and feel it and see if it's right. What you're really doing is validating if what you've identified in these three stages is necessary. And with that, that's when we talk about the users, right? That's when we talk about really pushing ourselves and stretching ourselves past who our user is to validate the ideation that we have. Then we're gonna test it to make sure everything is working. And when we test, we're gonna test on all devices. We're gonna test on all ages. We're gonna test on all genders. We're gonna test on all racial demographics. A great example I have about when testing went wrong is when smartwatches came out. There were some smartwatches that when they were deployed in the store, ready for purchase, actually did not work on dark-skinned individuals, right? And it was like, well, what? How'd that happen? Like, how'd you guys get all the way through this process and like that didn't happen, right? Because when they got to testing, they were focused on, does it work? Not, does it work for everyone? And then, of course, the fun part, we wanna implement, we wanna deploy, and we wanna make sure it's happy. But what happens when we get to implement? We're gonna implement, and then we're ready to refine. And we're ready to challenge this process, and then we're gonna start all over. Because by the time we deploy, we're then gonna start getting real feedback. What works, what doesn't work. And if anyone has been in the development process of a web app or a database solution or a mobile app, once you get to deployment, someone comes to you and like, well, I just can't figure out how to get to the menu when I'm on this page. And you're like, you're stupid. Like, that's your problem, it's not me. Be smarter, right? Know how to use technology better. But we're not gonna do that. We're actually gonna go back to empathy and say, okay, what's the common basic denominator of why they don't know how to do this, right? And we're gonna challenge ourselves and say, what didn't we do right? We all can do this, right? Okay, good. Okay. So when we do that, that's us building with implicit UX design. What that can cause us to do sometimes is have very simplistic technology, which is seen in the world of technology as not a very cool thing to have, but it is. So here's an example of an internal project we did at our firm, simply just for fun, to get our interns moving. And what we did was, the idea was, what if you could actually have an organic chat with someone of history? So what if you could like chat MLK or chat Einstein and like have this organic conversation? It stemmed from the problem of teenagers learn differently now and they depend on their phones, so how can we speak to them correctly? So at first, when we went into empathy, we said, okay, we have to empathize with teenagers. We have to really understand what's their common basic and they like to message, right? No one at our firm understood that. We all thought it was stupid. We were not very happy with the concept, but we had to get to that common basis. And then we had to say, well, what if someone of older, that our teacher or someone else also wanted to utilize the system? So then we had to make it a very simplistic platform. So what it did is it created a very simple app that wasn't very flashy, but was super cool and was implemented in schools pretty easily. And all it was a natural language processor that allowed you to have this organic chat with MLK, but then we added some gamification concepts where he would quiz you on how cool he was. And it was pretty successful. Was it simple? Yes. Did we have to empathize and lower our feature components? Yes, but we ideated and created something that was pretty significant. So here's some things that I wanna make sure that you guys do next time that you're going in to build a technology solution. So the first one is, of course, flip the narrative. When you're talking about your user, figure out who that user is, see them sitting at the table. Everyone has a vision of who that user is going to be, so now you're going to make the complete opposite of that person. You're gonna flip the narrative. If you find yourself keep saying we or he, right, then you're gonna challenge yourself to create a new persona where you're saying she, or they, right? If you're envisioning a different age group, then that's younger, you wanna flip the narrative and try to envision that person at an older age. Same thing with phones and things like that. You do wanna question yourself. That comes with just being activating your unconscious bias, being very honest with the elephant in the room, and saying, you know, do we have biases here simply because we don't have the demographic that we need, or we're not as diverse as we should be? It's very easy to see diverse as race and gender, as we've seen today. It's not just about that, right? It's about age, it's about phones, devices, utilization of technology. We want to make sure that you're always acknowledging that. Oh, yes. What do you mean by that?
When you see people grouped together, sometimes they will be grouped together. They look diverse, but it's the same personality type in a room.
Mm-hmm.
It's all developers or all HR. Elementary school teachers are 75% of one personality type.
Yeah. I agree with that. Yeah. When we go into to corporations and we do this workshop, we also say in the room, if you're doing some enterprise development, you should have every single level of jobs in that ideation process. So you need to have from the secretary to the higher level CEO to that one person that doesn't really work but like always is involved. Right, you wanna have like all those people there as well as the developers and the adapters and the implementers. So we do touch on that, but I think there's something deeper there about personality type that I challenge you all to figure out. So I love that, thank you. And then, of course, you want to hold yourself and others accountable. You do want to raise your hand as much as possible if you're in that ideation mode and say, you know, I think we're speaking from bias. I think we're speaking from assumptions. So I just really want us to make sure we're not doing that. I know that can be very difficult in moments of development because that can be seen as slowing down a process or not getting to a solution. But there's nothing more frustrating than when you build something and it sucks. So think of it and empower yourself to say, I'm doing this, so we only have to cut once, right? And we don't have to go back. And then find the power of empathy. Empathy is very stretching as a developer. We know what we're doing, we've been taught to know what we're doing, we've been taught to be very decisive people, we've been taught to be the solution providers. So finding empathy really means you have to empathize for the person you're finding the solution for, which we can easily have unconscious bias about. So really getting to the point where you're building with empathy as much as possible. Because the reality is we are building for everybody. So in this world of Salesforce and development, we are now at a point where we have the ability to build so many things, right? We've been handed the key of all types of innovation, and it's really fantastic. But when we're doing that, we now have to fight the challenge of building for so many platforms, for so many ages, for so many genders, arrangements for so many people that use technology in different ways. So it's understanding that the power we have is very important and we're very cool and smart individuals, but at the end of the day, we're building solutions for people that are going to use them every day and that matter. So I end with you this. What are the quick things you can do once you go back to your ideation? Once you go back to your companies and you start building these digital solutions. And I believe that you, depending on where you are in your development process or where you are in your position, you can implement these immediately. And that's, of course, add a step to your profile development. So every time, even if you're an admin and you're in charge of creating those user profiles, right, and then someone comes to you and they say, the VP wants his own user profile on Salesforce. And you're like, okay, right? And you do that very quick and you like limit all the restrictions and you just have these like immediate preconceived notions of what this executive should and should not allow you to do. Stretch yourself to think past that point. Walk down to their secretary and say, hey, I know you're gonna be utilizing his user from time to time. I know you actually are probably gonna be the person in there for him. Let's have a conversation about what you need. Let me figure out how you're a part of this user profile as well. So really stretching yourself and add that step to dive a little deeper of your profile development. Remove the sources of bias, right? So that means if you're in the situation where your team is all one thought, right, figuring out a way to remove that and force them to look beyond themselves. You want to increase awareness through open discussion, so talk about bias, and then try your best to produce a more diverse team. And these are some don'ts. I have one big do, right? Don't build for yourself. It's really easy for us to do so. Don't build without empathy or without intention. And don't build apologetically. Don't build where you're gonna have to say sorry later. Sorry I didn't think about that, or sorry you weren't in the room to tell me that you needed that to happen. So try to make that you don't have to say sorry later and build with everybody in mind. Because the truth of the matter is, We all are a part of technology, and I encourage you all to be the change that you wish to see in the world. Thanks, everyone. Cool. Any questions? Yeah.
Could you please go back to your bio slide with your icons?
Yes.
So as you were walking through that, I've got a really diverse set of friends, and some of my...
Oh, the emojis. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
And so some of my friends who are women of color wouldn't think about this, some would, but to have the white blonde bride and the yellow family. I noticed that immediately, like, oh, I wonder how she felt about choosing the icons, because I think on my phone they don't offer a lot of different color icons.
Yeah.
Yeah,
only for some. When I did this, there was not a brown bride. Yeah, I didn't have a brown bride option. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah. It's a very, and I think we talk very high level of what technology and unconscious bias is, but it is as simplistic as something as an emoji. Emoji development is one of the most obvious uses of unconscious bias in the world. That's why there's so many Bitmoji and emoji keyboards now, because there's people fixing the biases that exist with the standard emoji. So this is an example of building apologetically. Yes, but when I did this, I did not have the option of a brown bride, but I was a bride, and I was going to put that in there. So you raised your hand raised? Right. No, I agree. I don't have a solution for it, but I agree.
But I'll continue this talk it up with someone does.
Yes, I love that. I think we go to a lot of development houses. We actually talk to a lot of developers about building without bias, and we try to use as many examples that we try to use, but what it does, what I want you all to leave here empowered to do is to call out the bias in existing technology. We have the joy of, we work with a number of development houses that have built with bias, and we get to go to them and say, you did it wrong. We train them on how, and then we rebuild their solution without bias in it. And they usually don't like us for it because we simplify their applications most of the time. So it is finding those moments and being okay and comfortable with saying, hey, you did this wrong. I'm a proponent to tweeting whoever built whatever and be like, you did this wrong, and let me tell you why, and I encourage you to do that. I think it's three. I think it is developers, it's the user experience designers, and then it is the database developers, because they're in charge of that validation concept. So all three of these people have a responsibility. If I'm a very conscious developer and I build a very strong database with low validators, but then you take that and you build a mobile app with user experience that completely takes that away, because you're not going to see my back end, right? Then you're now part of the problem. Right, so if you do that, and then you also build a mobile app that doesn't really respond right to people, so then the user experience designer did their job, and then the developer did their job, but you deployed an app that didn't do it, right? Because now you're not showing what we did. So I think it is that those three people need to have a really honest conversation about what it means to build without bias.
And when did they reach out to you to realize that they have a problem like that that they need to fix?
So most of the most times we go to them. We're obsessed with technology, so we try to find it ourselves. From time to time, if it does come to us, it comes from the product person that is talking about the lack of adoption, or we get people telling us that they don't like our app and we don't know why.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of that. So, any more questions? I think in the world of development, I think age is still a big issue. We still have preconceived notions on how teenagers, millennials, non-millennials, and older affect technology. We build very different for those three people. And we assume when we build is once we pick one of those, that the other two don't exist. And I think it's an unfair advantage, and it's the reason why some of us have parents that call us and say, how do I do anything, right? Because it wasn't built for them. So I think age is actually one of the biggest. And then devices, I would say also, of we build with intentional devices in mind.
I also point out the LGBTQ.
Yeah.
That there are a lot of people really struggle with the gender pronouns and
yeah.
when someone wants to change, or they may have a male name but wants to refer to the female pronoun. A lot of companies across the board are really struggling with that.
Yeah. I agree.
I think the really large group that we don't address, hardly anybody ever does, is handicapped people, accessibility, blind people.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't realize it, but blind people make up 5% of
yeah.
the population the internet is. And it's very, very, very few applications
mm-hmm.
these days actually concern themselves with that. Only the very top applications usually have the time to do that.
I
and
agree.
A lot of it is a result of the modern way that we build apps that we use. JavaScript to do all the dynamic rendering and stuff like that. We make things less accessible and less available to people by trying to make them fancier.
Right. I mean, a good example of that is in mobile applications. You see it a lot of there's actually a gender bias in how small or large you make your point of what you click on mobile apps. So there's some mobile apps that were designed with, I don't know, with if you see a man-built mobile app, it has a bigger press point, right? And it does force. It was built by a younger person, actually has a smaller press point. We build a lot for right-handed people, not a lot for left-handed prominent people. So you do see that a lot in mobile application of simply about where you put your menu is showing your bias. Yeah. Yeah. So what do you mean by not being able to change it? Yeah.
I'm like, okay, I'm not gonna wear that strength of glasses.
Right.
And I have money.
Yeah.
Don't have money.
Right.
Right. A lot of times people use that like gray text and it's really hard to read.
Yeah. Gray text is in.
Colorblind.
Yeah.
Because there's a big percentage of people who are colorblind, and unless you are, then
yeah.
you don't think about what that.
Yeah. And the weirdest part about some of these is if you go in, going back to ideation, even if you are hiring someone to build your mobile app, if you say we want it to be color accessible, right, it probably will raise your budget by $1,000. Like, it's not even from a developer's perspective, it actually doesn't take that much to add in that functionality. Even language, adding in multiple languages, does not cost you that much money. But it's a perception of if we stretch ourselves, we're actually going to raise our budget. Being inclusive actually is cheaper, right? You're gonna lower your feature concepts. You're actually gonna be able to ideate and build faster when you go down to the lowest common denominator of people, that empathetic building. I love this, this was great. Can we just live here?
Yeah.
This is fantastic.
If we're gonna get home.
I know, it's true, it's true. So, thank you guys so much. This was so much fun.
Yeah.
Thanks. Continue the convo on Twitter.